Let us build a house where love can dwell and all can safely live.
Blessings from Union Avenue.
Blessings from Union Avenue. Hello, church. At Blessings from Union
Hello,
Avenue.
Church. Blessings from Union Avenue.
Hello, church. And blessings from Union Avenue.
Good morning, church.
Hello, church. And blessings from Union Avenue.
Hello, church. And blessings from Union Avenue.
Good morning, church. And blessings from Union Avenue.
Hello, church. And blessings from Union Avenue.
Good morning, church.
And blessings from Union Avenue.
Hello, church. And welcome to Union Avenue Christian Church.
Hello, church. And blessings from Union Avenue.
Good morning, church. And blessings from Union Avenue.
Hello, church. And blessings from Union Avenue.
All creatures of our God and King, lift up your voice and with us sing.
Everyone, and greetings to you all this day. Christian artwork is a funny thing, it seems, when it comes to depicting Jesus Christ. Now, there are no shortage of images, to be clear, from marble to canvas, catacomb fresco to frozen butter carvings. Every medium imaginable has been used to bring Jesus to life through art. I especially appreciate the 200-pound, 6-foot-tall, anatomically correct 2007 statue of Jesus made completely from milk chocolate by renowned food artist Cosimo Cavallaro, totaling 485,460 calories and simply entitled, My Sweet Lord. Amazingly, while there are innumerable depictions of Jesus through the centuries, none of them look like the Jesus of Scripture. Because there is no description whatsoever of what he looks like in any of our sacred writings. We don't have a clue. And because of this, every age and culture has been able to depict Jesus in ways that show him to be like them. Lon Chaney, nothing. Jesus is the real man of a thousand faces, and several factors of 10 more than that, really. What puzzles me, however, is that in addition to stigmata, there is one other biblically-based physical identifier that should be universally found in the depiction of Jesus, but isn't. And that is the large and deep indentation of his forehead from all the times he had to facepalm himself because of his disciples and their ever-present idiocy, such as described in a story from the Gospel according to Luke. As the story goes, Jesus and company are about to leave behind their Galilean ministry and head toward Jerusalem itself. Now, the road to Jerusalem took them through Samaria, the land of the Judeans' distant cousins who, centuries and centuries and centuries in the past, dared to believe that God could be worshipped on Mount Gerizim just as well as on Mount Zion. And ever since, there was bitter enmity and racial hatred between the two peoples. Jesus sends some disciples ahead through a Samaritan village to see if he could acquire accommodations. But the Samaritans did not receive Jesus because he was going to Jerusalem. Now, on what mount was the city of Jerusalem? Mount Zion. There is an enormous subtext of racial and religious discrimination in our story. But don't think that the discrimination was one-sided. As if the refusal of the Samaritans wasn't bad enough on their side, James and John, two of Jesus' Judean disciples, saw this interfaith inhospitality and decided to dial it up to 11, saying, "Lord, do you want us to command fire to come down from heaven and consume them?" All this time, Jesus has been preaching and teaching of the reconciliation of all peoples and nations, preaching and teaching and even reaching out to persons different from themselves, crossing racial, ethnic, and religious divides. And now, all of a sudden, the disciples want to be all fire and brimstone? No wonder Scripture says the next thing Jesus did was to rebuke them. And as eloquent as the Son of God could be, I've no doubt that he didn't mince words. Why do so many Christians have such a hard time accepting people who don't believe or practice their faith in the same way as themselves? We keep dividing and dividing and dividing until there's nothing left in common. How's that old church saying go? Where two or three are gathered together, you can still have a schism. What's strange is that over and over again, Scripture teaches us that correct belief or correct practice isn't what concerns Jesus. Rather, it's the correct orientation of the heart toward loving and serving one's neighbor in the ways they need, even at personal cost. It's love put to action, such as in the parable of the sheep and the goats from Matthew's gospel, where Jesus says that every time we do something for the least of these that society ignores, abandons, and makes to suffer, that we are doing it to Jesus himself. And loving others in the ways they need is something we can all do in Jesus' name. This is why the Apostle James writes in his epistle, "Faith by itself, if it has no works, is dead." Yet at the same time, James is not saying that faith doesn't matter. True, at the end of the day, what matters is how love has been put to action. But such loving action has always found itself rooted in faith of some kind. And while I would hope we all facepalm, if not grimace, at the disciples James and John when they suggest a fiery conflagration for those whose religious practice and beliefs were different than theirs, It's also wrong to completely erase our Christian identity under the false assumption that faith isn't as important as love. We are a forgetful people, after all. And on our own, without a faith in something greater than ourselves, and without a faith narrative that forms our individual identities toward faithfully loving others, we find ourselves merely striving to be nice people, when nice by itself ain't enough to change the world. The author of 2 Timothy writes the church during a time when some were teaching a way of thinking called Gnosticism. Gnosticism denied the importance of earthly things and bodily existence in favor of the spiritual and intellectual. It taught that Jesus was not fully human, but was a divine spirit that appeared in the world, but wasn't really a flesh and blood being. What was important to Gnostics was how Jesus revealed secret knowledge of God, by which we could learn and participate in the divine ourselves. It was as if our embodied humanness, our daily living and context, our peculiarities and contextualities somehow weren't important. And of course, nothing could be further from the truth of the Christian faith. You see, at the very core of our faith story is that of a God who made the world and all therein, including us, and called it good. Our God chose to be in covenant with people in their earthly form and not just their spirits. Our God worked to liberate people from physical oppression and injustice, delivering them from slavery by parting the physical sea and not just having an intellectual discussion with Pharaoh. Our God was with the exiles in Babylon during their harsh physical captivity, and was with them in rebuilding their physical lives from the ruins when they returned generations later. Our God even came to be with us as one of us in the person of Jesus Christ, who we acknowledge to be the Son of God. And because He's the Son of God, that makes us all children of God, in case we had forgotten that, and siblings to each other. And two, that meant that Caesar, who was really good at oppressing human bodies through slavery and systemic injustice, was not the Son of the Most High God, as Caesar wanted everyone to proclaim. Jesus, the Son of God, was put to a physical death on a Roman cross because he was a revolutionary against a system that said human bodies and embodied existence didn't matter except for what value they added to the Roman economy. And his bodily, physical resurrection from said cross told the world that living, breathing human bodies mattered more to God than worldly wealth, and that God was more powerful than human violence and death dealing. Friends, the Christian faith at its heart is all about who we are, how we are unique and uniquely embodied, how we each have different experiences and contexts, different understandings and practices, and that such difference shouldn't be cast aside, but rather celebrated and embraced and brought together in unity, not uniformity. The image of God and humanity has billions of faces. The story of Jesus Christ teaches us this. We should not be ashamed that we are Christians, if we but remember and bring to life this larger story of a love that embraces the world's diversity and transforms humanity into a family that accepts it, nurtures it, celebrates it, and grows closer together because of it. We don't have to believe alike to love alike. As the late Bishop John Shelby Spong wrote, God is not a Christian, God is not a Jew, or a Muslim, or a Hindu, or a Buddhist. All of those are human systems which human beings have created to try to help us walk into the mystery of God. I honor my tradition. I walk through my tradition. But I don't think my tradition defines God. I think it only points me to God. Or as a popular meme that's always making the rounds these days reads, a Christian, a Muslim, a Jew, and an atheist walk into a coffee shop, and they talk and laugh and drink coffee and become very good friends. It's not a joke. Honestly, it's what happens when you're not a jerk. There are many paths toward not being a jerk toward one another, and Jesus is one of them. He happens to be our path, our way, our truth, our life, and that's okay. That doesn't invalidate someone else's path that may be different from ours. In fact, coming together and learning from each other only gives us a deeper appreciation for the other person's experience as well as for our own. We can learn from one another's faith traditions, estranged siblings, reunited after long divergent journeys back home to a table where we feast together in peace, a human family made whole once again with wildly and wondrously different stories of how we got here. My friends, as we move from homecoming to home building and work to rebuild the church from the wake of COVID-19 and the end of 20th century Christendom, we've rediscovered some long-lost and indispensable tools. Storytelling. Witnessing to the worthiness of God. And today, telling our story and giving witness to Christ, both with deep confidence and conviction, and also with deep appreciation and honor for other faith traditions. Jesus plays well with others. It says so right on his grade card. And any church in his name should be getting the same grade as he. In fact, it's precisely because of the unique path of following Jesus that we come to embrace diversity with a true appreciation for difference and a faith in our unity of love beyond belief. And so, as we consider the ministry of reconciliation that has been given to us as the church, hear these words of Scripture from 2 Timothy. Do not be ashamed, then, of the testimony about our Lord, but join with me in suffering for the gospel. Hold to the standard of sound teaching that you have heard from me, in the faith and love that are in Christ Jesus. Guard the good treasure entrusted to you with the help of the Holy Spirit living in us. For the life of the world to come, let the people of God say, Amen.
Thank you. It's funny, I don't remember no good dope days. I remember walking for miles in a dope fiend haze. I remember sleeping in houses that had no electric. I remember the birthdays. I remember overdosing on the bedroom floor. I remember feeling like I had lost all hope. When I was 19, I was diagnosed with HIV, and I took it very hard. I was extremely sick, didn't know what was wrong. I was in the hospital for almost 2 months, and at that time I had lost all my hair and was extremely lethargic, couldn't eat anything. They had put a feeding tube in me, and I thought I was gonna die. I really did. And at 19, it was terrifying. I was very bitter at first at the world, at life. It was like running full speed into a brick wall. A few years down the road, I ended up meeting a guy. We started a relationship, and things were going okay. And it kind of went sour after I ended up pregnant, and I had my son early, and he ended up passing away. And I took that pretty rough. Shortly after that, my father passed away. So I took that a little rough. And I ended up drinking quite a bit, which led to me doing drugs. And I started on heroin. It was just a downhill snowball that grew rapidly. 2 months turned into 2 years, turned into, 10 years real quick. And I lived on the street for quite a while. I had children during the course of this time, and I have 3 boys at the moment. And, I thank God for them every day. But when you're out there like I was, those things don't cross your mind, and taking meds doesn't cross your mind either. So, of course, naturally, time takes its toll on you, and I ended up sick again. I ended up back in the hospital on my deathbed, and then I had 2 people sitting in my room I didn't know from a can of paint, Tracy and Taylor, with doorways. I didn't know these people. They didn't know me. My family wasn't dealing with me. But these 2 people that didn't even know me gave me a home. And they put me back in touch with my family, my children. They got me the help I needed. I had somewhere to call home. I have somewhere to lay my head. I have food every day. I talk to my children every day. I talk to my brothers and my sister every day. I don't have to worry about being out in the cold. I don't have to worry about when am I going to eat again. I don't have to worry about any of those things. If it wasn't for them, I probably wouldn't be alive. I could not have done it without doorways. And because of them, I got into rehab. They got me into rehab. And I've been clean for 18 months now. I have a life. I'm living now. I'm not dying. I'm not just existing. I'm actually living.
Things I missed during my incarceration. I remember 18 months to this day.
I was blessed to reconnect with my 3 kids, my 3 boys. They are my heart, my love, the core of my joy. I could go on forever about all Doorways has done for me, but we'd be here all night. To put it simply, they give me back my life.
Dear friends, as you go into the world, know that it is varied and beautiful. Seek wisdom wherever it is to be found. And may the goodness of the Creator, the companionship of the Christ, and the insight of the Spirit infuse your life now and always. Amen.